Ik. Let us return back to our theme, to the cerebellum. So, cerebellum is divided to three lobes, anterior, posterior and floculonodular, which are indicated here in different colors. Red is anterior, green is posterior, and blue is floculonodular or vestibular. Functional denomination is spinal cerebellum for the anterior lobe, pontine cerebellum for the posterior lobe, and vestibular cerebellum for the floculonodular lobe. Showing that each lobe of the cerebellum, anterior lobe is up to the primary fissure, and primary fissure makes boundary between the anterior and posterior lobe. Anterior lobe is divided to five lobuli, and while posterior lobe, which is indicated in white color, consists of lobule number 6, 7, 8, 9. The oculonodular lobe is indicated by the number 10. So together, cerebellum is divided to three lobes, but to the 10 lobuli. In each lobulus is lobuli are designated by Roman numerals, but if you are describing lobuli in extent of the hemisphere, you are using the H number. For example, H4, H5, H6 indicate that this lobule in the extent of the hemisphere. If it's somewhere written only Roman numeral without H, it means that we are describing vermis of the cerebellum. Between the vermis and hemisphere are not boundary. This line indicates the separation of the vermis from the hemisphere, but it is possible only on the basis of the projections of the cerebellum, projection originated in the vermis and projection originated in the extent of the hemisphere. So once more, three lobes and 10 lobuli. In addition to vermis and hemisphere, the basis of connectivity of the cerebral cortex is delineated also paravermal area. So, paravermal area, it is medial part of the hemisphere, white. Hemisphere is most lateral part of the cerebellar cortex, and in close to the midline is vermis of the cerebelli. Concerning the cerebellar nuclei, so cerebral nuclei are evident on the horizontal section of the cerebellum, or slightly oblique section, and cerebral nuclei are three on each half of the cerebellum. It is dentate nucleus, which is folded in blue color, medially to dentate, and in the vicinity of the hilum of the cerebellum is emboliform nucleus, and most medial is fastigial nucleus. Cerebral nuclei contain neurons. Majority of neurons is glutamatergic excitatory neurons, and typical for these neurons is their high spontaneous activity. And in addition to glutamatergic neurons, there is also also interneurons, which are inhibitory, but the number is much smaller in comparison with the excitatory glutamatergic neurons. And now we should describe the structure of the cerebral cortex. It was mentioned formerly that cortex consists of three layers. First layer is named molecular layer. Molecular layer contains small amount of cells, which are inhibitory interneurons and are divided to two subpopulations. One is named basket cells and the other one stellate cells. And all these interneurons are inhibitory, so they use as a neurotransmitter JBA, GABA aminobutyric acid. Second layer is Purkinje cell layer. Purkinje cells are inhibitory cells, GABAergic, and Purkinje cells project to the cerebellar nuclei. Third layer is sick and is named granular layer. And in the granular layer prevail excitatory granular neurons. And also neurotransmitter of these neurons is excitatory neurotransmitter glutamate. In the granular layer prevail excitatory granular neurons also. And glutamate, these neurons are glutamatergic, but third layer contains smaller amount of the inhibitory neurons. Thickness of the cortex is about 1 millimeter. It is histological section showing internal structures of one folium or one gyrus of the cerebellum, and evident are three layers. So under the surface is molecular layer containing small amount of basket and stellate cells. Next is a layer of Purkinje cells, yes? And deep to the Purkinje cells is third layer of the granular cells. Reddish color indicates the white fibers of the white matter penetrating to the interior of the folium. These small reddish areas between the granular cells are named cerebral islands. And later was discovered that cerebral islands are place of the complex synaptic contact, which will be described immediately later. So three layers of the cerebellum, and second layer is layer of large Purkinje cells. Distances between the Purkinje cells are approximately not same, but there are not great differences between distance between two Purkinje cells. Purkinje cells were discovered in 1837, and at that time Purkinje was student of the Charles University, and after graduation he worked as a prosector of anatomy at Anatomical Institute of the Medical Faculty, and after 10 years spent in Prague, he left the Prague and was appointed as a professor of physiology, but not anatomy, in the University of Breslau. Breslau is recently in Poland and is named Wratislav. Breslau was formerly part of the Germany. And Purkinje, in 1932, University of Breslau bought for the Purkin a relatively good microscope, and enlargement of this microscope was about 1,000, and Purkinje started to analyze all tissues which he had to disposal, and among them also were pieces of the brain, not human but brain of the animals, and he described many types of the cells in the various tissues. And in the cerebellum of the sheep, he described such large cells which have elongated pear-shaped cell body. He distinguished the nucleus, and inside of the nucleus something. We know that it is nucleolus. And in the apex of each cells, from apex emanate one or two processes, and we know that these processes are extremely branched. But in time of the Purkinje, it was not visible because Purkinje used organic stains, and they don't depict the peripheral branching of the dendrites. It is summarizing picture. Everything was drawn by Purkinje, and under the layer of the Purkinje cells was layer of the granular cells, extreme density of the granular cells. But what is interesting that in the first layer, Purkinje doesn't found any cells, so basket and solid cells were not described by the Purkinje. It is strange because these cells are much larger than granular cells, but granular cells Purkinje recognize. Purkinje demonstrate his findings, and among them also finding of these large cells in the conference of German medicine and natural sciences, which was in 1837 in Prague. And this conference wandered through all German university towns, and last town where this conference was Prague. And so it was for the first time that this conference was organized in Prague. The idea of this conference originates in Johann Wolfgang Goethe, who stimulate his friend Count Sternberg, and Sternberg collected money for organized everything and invite to the Prague everybody who has some work in the macroanatomy, the histology, embryology, and other branches of the morphology. And this conference was extremely successful, not only for the attendance of the Purkinje, but many other people attend also. Description of the Purkinje cells and other cells were published in this papers from the conference, and then it was called Bericht auf der Versammlung Deutsche Naturforschung Ärzte in Prague, but it was published in German, and people from other language areas were not interested very much about the German published the papers published in the Germany. But Ramóni Cajal, who was Spanish neuroanatomist and neurohistologist, in his large monography Histology, the System Nervous, published in Paris, write that Purkinje cells are cells which could be named according to men who discovered them. large cells, ovoid or semilunar or mitral-like, and are placed in one layer, and there is evident discontinuity of these cells, so intervals between cells are evident. And these cells are placed between the layer of between the plexiform layer and between the layer of granular cells. Cells, the gran are granular cells in France. Their diameter are between the 35 to 65 microns. So Purk Ramon Cajal introduced the finding of the Purkinje to the world literature. This is a picture from the Ramon Cajal monography. It is all pictures were done by the Cajal. Cajal was very excellent in drawing, and this drawing indicates the large Purkinje cells with nucleus and with many granules inside of the cell body. In addition, basket cells and stellate cells in the layer above the layer of Purkinje cells, and in the granular layer are evident nuclei of the granular cells, but not cytoplasm, because cytoplasm forms a very narrow rim around the nucleus, and the whole element is about the 6-7 microns, so these cells are extremely small, and in between there are Golgi cells, which are dispersed between the granular cells. And what is interesting that Cajal also discovered that there are free spaces between granular cells, which to distinguish what is inside of these free areas, free spaces. Later was discovered that these free areas, these islands of the cerebellum, contains synaptic contacts. Sometimes was used also for these free areas termed glomerulus, cerebellar glomerulus. Another staining indicating branching of the dendrites of the Purkinje cells. Dendrites ramify in the molecular layer, and impregnation these Purkinje cells from cerebellum of the human, and you see that the dendrites are extremely branched, and branches or dendrites of the first order are divided to branches of the second order, and this gives branches of the fourth, fifth, and other orders. So whole ramification is very large, very extreme, and free spaces between individual branches are filled by the fibers, which passes mediolaterally through the cerebellar cortex. Under the layer of the Purkinje cells is layer of granular cells. Look on the very high density of granular cells. This picture shows what it is basket cells. The term, this is dendrites of the basket cells, and each basket cells gives of one axon. An axon gives collaterals, and collaterals branch in form of the small basket around the cell body of the Purkinje cells. So basket cells give many axosomatic synaptic contacts with the cell bodies of the Purkinje cells. Basket and stellate cells are inhibitory interneurons, and as a neurotransmitter is used GABI. But Purkinje cells is also inhibitory cells, also use the GABA. So cells in the first two layers of the cerebellum, in the first layer and second layer, are inhibitory cells. Purkinje cells and basket and stellate cells are inhibitory. So ramification of the, interesting is that ramification of the Purkinje cells are situated perpendicularly to long axis of the fovea. So in your cerebellum, dendrites of the Purkinje cells are oriented in sagittal plane, so anteroposteriorly. In all foveas of the cerebellum, in all gyri of the cerebellum. And these dendritic arborization is penetrating by fibers which passes mediolaterally, so perpendicularly to the dendritic tree of the Purkinje cells. And Purkinje cells are influenced by two types of fibers. One type is named MOSI fiber, and MOSI fiber terminate in the granular cells. This is a typical example of the MOSI fiber, and MOSI fibers have contacts with the granular cells. Second type of the fibers entering the cerebral cortex are climbing fibers, and climbing fibers climb along the dendrites of Purkinje cells. So climbing are longer because the branch along the dendritic arborizations of the Purkinje cell. It's another example of the ramification of the dendritic ramification of the Purkinje cells. Dendritic ramification is very narrow. It is few micrometers, but anteroposteriorly is very extensive. Yes? So this is excellently evident from this picture. And these areas, grayish areas, indicate ramification of Purkinje cells which are in the neighbor. It is basket cells, evident, and these fibers is climbing fiber, which climbs along the dendrites of the Purkinje cells, and it is MOSI fiber. MOSI fiber gives collaterals which have synaptic contacts with the granular cells. Now, from previous pictures was evident that cerebral cortex much receives some fibers. Basic parcellation is to the climbing and MOSI fibers. But these fibers originate from some structures. So, afferent structures or fibers originating from the spinal cord and brainstem are concerning the cerebral cortex afferent. So typical example is vestibulocerebellar fibers or tracts, which originates in the labyrinth and in the vestibular nuclei and terminate in the cerebellum in form of the MOSI fibers. Spinocerebellar fibers are anterior, posterior, rostral, and cuneocerebellar. Terminates mainly in the anterior lobe. This one terminates in the vestibular cerebellum. This one in the spinocerebellum, which is anterior lobe. And following is olivocerebellar fibers, which originates in the inferior olive. And these fibers enter the cerebellum and terminate as a climbing fibers. So all climbing fibers originate in the inferior olive. In addition to these, there are other afferent fibers emanating from the reticular formation, so reticulocerebellar nucleocerebellar from the nuclei of the cranial nerve, and pontocerebellar. Pontocerebellar fibers represent the second neuron of the cortico-pontocerebellar link. Pontocerebellar fibers are form a very large bundle of fibers, and pontocerebellar contains 17 millions of fibers. So same number contains the pontocerebellar fibers terminating in the posterior lobe and in the form of the mossy fibers. So majority of fibers are mossy fibers with one exception, and these are olivocerebellar, which terminate as a climbing fiber. Efferent connections, so fibers leaving the cerebellum. So fibers originating in the cortex are axons of the Purkinje cells. Only Purkinje cells is efferent element of the cerebellar cortex. The other cells are interneurons. So corticonuclear fibers originate in the cortex and terminate in the cerebellar nuclei. Purkinje cells placed in the vermis of the cerebellum project to the fastigial nucleus. Paravermal zone, which is immediately laterally to the vermis. Purkinje cells of the paravermal zone send fibers and axons to the ambliform and globose nucleus. And lateral hemisphere of the cerebellum, Purkinje cells in the lateral hemispheres send fibers to the dentate nucleus. So there is basic topography. Most medial nucleus, most medial cortex project to the most medial nucleus, and lateral cortex project to the most lateral nucleus, to the dentate nucleus. And fibers leaving the cerebellum originates in the cerebellar nuclei. These fibers terminate in the brain stem and in the thalamus. There are several examples of the fibers terminating in the cerebellum and originating in the spinal cord. There's a posterior the spinocerebellar tract, anterior, rostral, and cuneocerebellar. Majority of the spinocerebellar fibers originate in the lamina 5, something in the lamina 7, and in the lamina 8. The functional analysis of the cerebellum during performing of simple movements is possible to depict with using of the magnetic resonance examination, which is this examination is followed by the analysis of the intensity of the signal, and this intensity is indicated by colors. So reddish yellow color indicates the very high activity of the respective cerebellar cortex. So this examination is named functional magnetic resonance, and this look that is clearly evident anterior lobe of the cerebellum. This is primary fissure dividing the anterior from the posterior lobe. It is vermal part of the cerebellum. This is hemisphere. These are hemispheres of the brain. And patient who was examined was asked to perform flexion and extension of the hand in the wrist joint. And after analyzing of the examination, it was evident that flexion and extensions of the hand are responsible for the activation of this part of the anterior lobe. So it is lateral and posterior part of the anterior lobe. Blue signal indicates the result of the flexion and extension of the foot in the ankle joint. So you see that activation of the cerebellum associated with the movements of the foot is much smaller, is indicated by the blue color, and the activation is less intensive also, and is situated to the mid, to the vermis of the anterior lobe. So movements of the lower limb are represented in medial part of the anterior lobe. Movements of the hand are represented in the lateral part of the anterior lobe of the cerebellum. These lines indicated the planes in which was cerebellum section. So this is lines of scout of the body examination. We can ask, we can order angle of plane. And depends what we want to examine. So, for examination of the cerebellum, are very useful these oblique planes, which could catch a large volume of the cerebellum in one section. If magnetic resonance was used for analysis of activation of the cerebral cortex and cerebellum cortex in during the movements of the hand, so this movement activate the hand area of the cerebral cortex and typical area of the anterior lobe of the cerebellum. So representation of activity, of functional activity in volunteer who performed repetitive movements of the fingers of the right hand, and these movements leads to activation of this part of the cerebral cortex and to this part of the cerebellar cortex. So it is due to the fact that fibers from the cerebral cortex pass to the pontine nuclei and pontine nuclei to the cerebellar cortex. So it indicates that there is a link between the cerebral and cerebellar cortex via corticopontine and crossed pontocerebellar fibers or tracts. Formally indicates that activation of the anterior lobe during the movements of the upper limb was more laterally than activation of the lower limb, which is more more anteriorly and most medially. Colors and dots indicate the termination of the afferent fibers terminating in the cerebral cortex. So blue color indicates the termination of the cuneocerebellar fibers, a green color dorsal spinocerebellar, and the dots, red dots, indicate the termination of the ventral spinocerebellar tracts. And this area of the vermis is activated by the primary vestibulocerebellar. Individual fibers, afferent fibers, terminate in the cerebral cortex in these areas, which respect the basic parcellation of the cerebellum to the spinal, pontine, and vestibular cerebellum. Cerebellum also receives projection from the trigeminal nuclei. So in trigeminal nuclei terminate in the hand area of the anterior lobe and in two additional areas of the posterior lobes. Concerning the, so all these fibers or activation of respective parts of the cerebral cortex is from the mossy fibers, because all these tracts, ventral spinocerebellar, cuneocerebellar, dorsal spinocerebellar, vestibulocerebellar, terminate as a mossy fibers. With exception of the olivocerebellar, which are the termination depicted by the yellow color, olivocerebellar terminates in form of the climbing fibers. Climbing fibers originate in the inferior olive. Each Purkinje cell receives only one climbing fibers, but these fibers exhibit many synaptic contacts with the Purkinje cells. Climbing fibers are excitatory. The neurotransmitter is used, glutamate, and their firing frequency of climbing fibers is very low, in contrast to the mossy fibers, which exhibits a very high frequency of the signals. Function of the climbing fibers are obviously silent fibers, and activity appears only in situations that there is some error in the execution of movements. So climbing fibers are sometimes called error indicators. If I want to perform some movement but it is impossible, there is some obstacle or some problem, this situation are activated climbing fibers and inform the Purkinje cells that something is wrong and that movement cannot be performed on the basis of movement plan, which is located in the cerebral cortex. It is branching of the climbing fibers, which extensively branch along the dendrites of the Purkinje cells. Climbing fibers originate in the complex of the olivary nuclei. Olivary nuclei are divided, are three: main olivary nucleus and accessory olivary nucleus. All olivary nuclei project to the contralateral cerebellar cortex, so this pathway is crossed. And accessory olivary nuclei project to the cerebellar vermis and to the vestibular cerebellum. Medial part of the main olivary nucleus, indicated by the red color, terminate on the Purkinje cells, which are in paravermal area. Lateral part of the inferior olive nucleus project to the most lateral part of the hemisphere. So repeatedly, we have there is evident mediolateral topography of the olivocerebellar projections, mediolateral organization of the climbing fibers. If we compare the climbing fibers with the mossy fibers, there is evident that mossy fibers, climbing originates from the inferior olive. It is only source of these fibers. But in contrast to these mossy fibers originate in the spinal cord, in the reticular formation, in the pontine nuclei, and in the nuclei of cranial nerves. Mossy terminate in the granular layer, and each of which contacts large number of the granular neurons, up to 20. granular cells, axons, contact large number of Purkinje cells via parallel fibers. Each Purkinje cell is contacted by large number of the parallel fibers, which practically half of million of parallel fibers pass through the dendritic ramification of the Purkinje cells. MOSI are excitatory. Glutamate is used as a neurotransmitter. Each MOSI fiber influences many Purkinje cells, but excitatory effect is weak. So if we want to provide excitation of the Purkinje cells, many MOSI fibers must be active together in one moment. And the function of the MOSI is these fibers provide precisely graded information about movement, about skin stimulation, about joint position, and about motor commands issued from the cerebellar cortex. So MOSI fibers operates in day, in night, in also in period of your sleeping. So in also in, during sleeping, your cerebellum is informed about your movements, because some people sleep and move with limbs and hands and rotate in the bed and so. So this is analyzed by the MOSI fibers, which these activities send to the cerebellar cortex. In contrast to this, so MOSI are continuously active, in contrast to the climbing, which are silent and are activated only in specific movements when we cannot perform movements which were planned by the cerebral cortex. Concerning the contacts of the MOSI fibers and the granular cells, each MOSI fiber terminates in a very extensive presynaptic contact. It is presynaptic part of the synapses, and these large presynaptic contact was formerly named island, cerebral island, but we know that it is now recently it is named Rosetta, because it resembles flower of the rose, and dots indicate the presence of the glutamate as a excitatory neurotransmitter. And you see that each Rosetta exhibits synaptic contacts with several dendrites of the granular cells which are in the vicinity. So each Rosetta is in contact with 20 granular cells. Largest afferent projections terminating in the cerebellum is corticopontine pathway. Corticopontine pathway originates from premotor, motor, sensory areas and associative visual areas, and these fibers form a bundle containing 17 million fibers and terminate in the ipsilateral pontine nuclei. And from the pontine nuclei pass pontocerebellar pathway to the opposite half of the cerebellum. So signals from the cerebral cortex are transported to the cerebellum via corticopontocerebellar pathway. So pontocerebellar pathway represents the largest contingent of the MOSI fibers. In a more advanced study, which was performed in monkey, macaca monkey, yellow areas of the cortex doesn't project to the pontine nuclei, but premotor, primary motor, sensory and associative areas of the parietal and temporal lobe intensely project to the pontine nuclei. But you see that each cortical area, for example, sensory motor, which is in green color, terminate in several islands of the pontine nuclei. Similarly, fibers from the premotor terminates in violet groups of pontine nuclei. So this is there is preserved somatotopic topographic organization, but this type of organization is called fractured somatotopy, because termination of the individual groups of fibers leaving from individual cortical areas terminate in isolated groups of pontine neurons. Cerebellum and function of the cerebral cells was deeply analyzed by physiologists, and among them it was John Eccles, who was awarded for his discoveries related to the cerebellar cortex and specifically to the Purkinje cells, was awarded by Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1963. Immediately after that, John Eccles was by Queen Elizabeth II knighted, and since that time we are calling him Sir John and not Professor Eccles. But we may use also nomination Professor Eccles, but more frequently used Sir John. And what discovered Sir John? Everything what is in white color is excitatory. Everything what is in black color is inhibitory. So cerebral cortex is targeted by the MOSI fibers, which terminates on the granular cells. MOSI fibers are white excitatory. Granular cells are white excitatory. Granular cells emanate the axon, which divides to two collaterals, which are named parallel fibers, and parallel fibers pass through dendritic arborization of the Purkinje cells and exhibit excitatory but very weak influence, very weakly influence the Purkinje cells. So if Purkinje cells should be activated, many thousands of parallel fibers should send signals to the dendritic arborization of the Purkinje. Second type of the fibers are climbing fibers. Climbing fibers are excitatory and terminate directly on the dendritic arborization, and each Purkinje cells has one climbing fibers, one own climbing fibers. So climbing fibers strongly influence Purkinje cells, but this influence is limited because activity appears only in situation when movement or some activity cannot be performed according to the plan placed in the cerebral cortex. So two basic types of afferentation of the Purkinje cells. So if Purkinje cells is activated, finally Purkinje cells sends fibers to the cerebellar nuclei, and this influence is inhibitory. So Purkinje cells inhibit high frequency of neurons in the cerebral nuclei, and these frequencies decreased. Interneurons are also inhibitory and inhibits cortical interneurons basket and stellate inhibit the Purkinje cells, and Golgi cells inhibit the granular cells. Golgi cells are inhibitory, located in the, among the granular cells. So this schema summarizes 20 years long period of very intensive research, which was performed by the John Deckles together with his co-works, and among them was Professor János Csendes-Tagotay from Budapest and Professor Masao Ito from Tokyo University. And one of the important findings was that intervals between surrounding Purkinje cells are practically same. Yeah? And if this schema, together with the distances between the Purkinje cells, was demonstrated by Eccles and Csendes-Tagotay to Professor Breitenberg, who worked in the Neurocybernetic Institute at Naples, and ask Breitenberg what he mean about such organization and about such arrangement of the cerebral cortex. And Breitenberg's response was very surprising, because Breitenberg said, "Gentlemen, it is their clock. Cerebral cortex operate as a clock, because signal which is conveyed via parallel fibers activate one Purkinje cells, and after that activate next Purkinje cells, but there is delay, and delay is regular. So regular delay in activation of the surrounding Purkinje cells is regular, so it must operate in the form of the clock." So let us return to the efferent connections of the cerebral cortex. Cerebral cortex project to the cerebellar nuclei. Vermis project to the fastigi nucleus, to the vestibular nuclei. And vestibular nuclei gives off vestibulospinal pathway, which influences the muscles of the nuchal region and the deep back muscles, dorsal muscles. So muscles which maintain anti-gravitatory position of the neck and trunk. Paravermal zone of the Purkinje cells of the paravermal zone project to the emboliform and globose nuclei, and these nuclei project to the nucleus rubber and to the reticular formation, and activity of the paravermal zone influences the activity in the rubrospinal and reticulospinal pathways. Purkinje cells in the lateral hemisphere influence the dentate nucleus, and dentate nucleus via thalamus influence the activity in the corticospinal pathway, which regulates the fine fragmented movements of the hand and digits. So this is basic schema. So yellow color indicates the vermis and vestibular nucleus. These Purkinje cells of the vermis project to the fastigial nucleus and to the vestibular nuclei. Paravermal area in red color project to the emboliform and globose, while lateral part of the hemisphere, or Purkinje cells in the lateral part of the hemisphere, influences the dentate nucleus. And dentate nucleus via thalamus influences the corticospinal pathway. So this is principle of the corticonuclear projection. And next step, we should explain the efferent projection. So we have targeted the cerebellar nuclei. But what more? Signals from the cerebellar nuclei are conveyed to the other structures. So fascicular nucleus send fibers to the vestibular nuclei and small amount to the reticular formation. Emboliform and globose send fibers to the reticular formation, to the rubber, and small contingent of the fibers terminate in the thalamus. In contrast to this, dentate nucleus project to the rubber, but majority of the fibers terminate in the contralateral thalamus, in the ventrolateral nucleus, VL, in the intralaminar thalamic nuclei, and in the ventral anterior. But important is that VL nucleus influences primary motor cortex, area 4 of the cerebral cortex. So, dentate nucleus has access to the primary motor cortex, has access to the influencing of the fine fragmented movements of the hand. For the discovery and for the organization of the projection of the dentate nucleus, was studied for many years by Victoria Chan Pelly, who worked in the United States, and he was native in Singapore, and he was excellent student in pre and postgraduate courses, and he published two important books. One is devoted to the dentate nucleus, and the second one to the cerebellar cortex. And how Victoria Chan Pelly worked? He transported substances which were radioactive isotopes, and she injected them to the dentate nucleus and followed the termination of these fibers, and it is this experiment which. Oh, hello. Sorry, moment. Oh, I am discussing the cerebellum. You see from this picture that majority of the fibers terminates in the thalamic nuclei. A small amount of fibers in reticular formation and in the rubber nucleus. It is summarizing picture which summarizes the results of injections to dentate nucleus. Each color indicates the one localization of the one injection of the isotope. And frontal sections to the monkey thalamus indicates the termination of the dentatothalamic fibers. Dentatothalamic fibers terminate in the VL, yeah, subnuclei of the ventralis lateralis. Something terminates in the intralaminar nuclei. You see that majority of the fibers terminate in the VL, and something also in the VPL, and something in the intralaminar nuclei, but majority of the fibers terminate in the VL nucleus. So dentatothalamic projections terminate mainly in the VL nucleus. So, the whole cerebral mechanism is part of the link between the cortex and cerebellum. These connections are organized as corticopontine fibers, excitatory, which activate the neurons in the pontine nuclei, and these neurons give off axons terminating in the cerebral cortex, so it is pontocerebellar crossed fibers terminating in the posterior lobe of the cerebellum, and this is also excitatory link. Cortico nuclear projections, which is represented by axons of the Purkinje cells, is inhibitory, because Purkinje cells are inhibitory elements, GABAergic, and corticonuclear terminate in the cerebral nuclei. In this case, it is dentate nucleus, and projections of the dentate nucleus terminate in the thalamus. So it is dentatothalamic or cerebellothalamic projections, and these projections. These signals are sent from the thalamic nuclei to the cerebral cortex. So there is circuit which is named transcerebellar circuit, cortex, pontine nuclei, cerebellar cortex, cerebellar nuclei, thalamus, and back to the cerebral cortex. So, concerning the functions of the cerebellum. Cerebellum receives extensive sensory input, but is not involved in voluntary discrimination of the signal, or is not involved in interpretation of the signal. So, important is the cerebellum operates the involuntary level. Cerebellum influences the motor functions, but resection of the cerebral cortex doesn't result in paralysis. If we resect, if we shall resect the cerebral cortex, we could evoke the paralysis. So, function of the cerebellum is regulation and coordination of movements. Function of the cerebellum regulates optimal course of the movements. Movements must be precisely performed and precisely targeted to some specimen, to some book, pen, or something like that. Cerebellum influences. A stimulation of the cerebral cortex doesn't evoke movements, because stimulation of the cerebral cortex means stimulation of the inhibitory cells, Purkinje cells, and Purkinje cells inhibit dentate or other nuclei of the cerebellum, and it is in fact blocking the movements. Finally, cerebellum influences cognitive functions, namely motor learning and higher mental function. So not only regulation of the movement, which is important aspect of the activity of the cerebellum, but also cognitive functions are regulated from the cerebellum. Functions of the cerebellum. Cerebellum maintain equilibrium and upright posture, regulate the muscle tone, control individual movements, determining their direction and length, coordinate alternating and differentiating movements, so you have flexion, extension, supination and pronation. If cerebellum is affected by some pathology, it is impossible to perform alternating movements. This function is damaged. Concerning the syndromes which are associated with the lesions of the cerebellum. Midline portion of the cerebellum may be affected by a tumor. Typically, it is medulloblastoma, that occurs in childhood. In adults, similar syndrome may be seen in chronic alcoholism, which causes degeneration of the vermis, neurons of the vermis. The patient has unsteady, staggering, ataxic gait, walks on a wide base, and sways from one side to side. So, present is also cerebral nystagmus, it's a pendular movements of the eyes. And so it is typical for the midline regions of the cerebrum, for the lesion of the vermis. So this syndrome is sometimes called paleocerebral lesion. If cerebrum is affected in the hemisphere, specifically in the lateral hemisphere, this syndrome is named neocerebellar syndrome. Movements are ataxic and there is significant dysmetria. For example, when dysmetria is tested in following manner, patient is asked to reach out with his finger to an object or tip of the nose or lobe of the auricle. Yeah. But he must, during this test, the patient must have closed his eyes. Yeah. And so in patient with lesions of the cerebral hemisphere is not able to perform this movement precisely. So these movements are obviously overshoot. Yeah? So he's not precisely target tip of nose, it's not precisely a target auricle. Rapidly alternating movements such as flexions and extensions or pronation and supination of the forearm are performed in clumsy manner. It is named adiadochokinesis. Asynergy is another sign. It is separation of smoothly voluntary movements into succession of mechanical or puppet-like movements. So it is named decomposition of the movement. It is typical for the cerebral lesions, for the lesion of the hemisphere. Also maybe hypotonia of the muscles and cerebral tremor. And cerebral tremor obviously occurs at the end of the particular movement. And this tremor is named intention tremor. Typically, when patient is asked to take a glass of water or a glass of tea, his limb is projected toward the glass, but in the last phases of the movement appears tremor. And patient is able to put the glass, but during tremor, the water or tea is dispersed from the glass. Another sign is this artery. It is typical cerebral speech, which is monotonous and scanning speech. So patient speech of the patient like this. Speech is without melody, is monotonous, yes, and sometimes is divided into small pieces of words. So scanning speech, slurring speech, it is typical for cerebellar lesions. And sometimes also maybe present nystagmus, so involuntary movements of eyeballs. In last period, it was 1998, was by two English neurologists working in London, Dr. Samadan and Sherman, described a group of patients, about 30 patients, with lesions of the posterior part of the vermis of the cerebellum. And in these patients was evident disturbances in planning, in abstract reasoning, and in memory. Language symptoms and changes in behavior. Behavior was, there appeared affective disturbances, blunting of affect, disinhibited and inappropriate behavior. So, these behavior affective disturbances were caused by lesion of the posterior midline vermis. This part of the vermis probably communicates with the limbic system of the brain. So, new type of the signs was discovered, and these are psychiatric, it's evident that psychiatric disorders may appear after lesion of the posterior part of the vermis of the cerebellum. So this syndrome is named cerebellar cognitive affective syndrome. So in addition to the cognitive functions, is executive, this planning, abstract reasoning, and memory functions, language function, there may be evident psychiatric disorders. It must be said that the number of these psychiatric disorders is very, very small. So this is end of our lecture oriented to the cerebellum. Thank you.